everyone, Alex from Beam is here, and welcome to the in-depth Beam video series. And in this episode, we will discuss the Beam wallet service and the web wallet, which is based on it. We will talk about the advantages and the challenges of this new architecture, what it can give us, and what problems it is intended to solve. So what we're going to talk about is the wallet communications model and how it works. What is the difference between integrated and remote nodes? What is the own node and the owner key? Why it's a bad idea to have multiple wallets with the same seed? And we will get to the idea of trustless centralized wallet service, which allows us to build web wallets. And in the end, I will also show the demo of the current in progress state of the Beam web wallet. Let's start by understanding exactly what functionality Beam wallet does today. So first of all, of course, it's managing all the keys. All the secret keys that are generated from a seed phrase and then used to create transactions, mark UTXOs, and all the other operations, including SBBS. The other part of the wallet functionality has to do with creating transactions. As you know, in Mimblewimble, since it's an interactive protocol, both wallets have to participate in the creation of the transaction. And this is why the wallet has to manage exactly the state of this communication and send information to one another to create the transactions interactively. The wallet is also holding all the history of transactions and UTXOs locally in the local database. And of course, the wallet also has to know the current state of the blockchain, the current blockchain height, which UTXOs were spent and which were not, and which transactions were mined. So if we take a look at the wallet communications, we see that the wallet actually communicates with the node to get all the information about the blockchain. And of course, there is also the wallet-to-wallet communication, which is done using the SBBS, which stands for Secure Bulletin Board System. SBBS is basically a distributed encrypted messaging system that allows two wallets to exchange encrypted messages and thus participate in the creation of the transaction. We will go into detail exactly how each of these communication modes work and what exactly they're doing under the hood. So every time you install a new wallet, you're presented with this setup node connectivity screen, which has three options. The first one is to run an integrated node, and it's a recommended option, which I believe most of our users choose by default. The second one is to connect to a random remote node, and the third one is to connect to a specific remote node. So let's see what are the differences between these modes and what they mean. So whenever you choose the first option and run an integrated node, both your wallet and your node are running on the same machine. The node is actually embedded within the wallet. And all the functions that we have discussed previously, the key management, the transaction history, and the blockchain updates, take place on your machine within your wallet. If you choose the remote node option, it means that the node is actually running on a different machine, and the wallet does not have any direct access to the blockchain related information any longer. So in this case, the wallet has to explicitly ask the node about all the blockchain related events that it wants to know about, such as UTXO state, the transaction state, and the blockchain height. For that, we use a separate protocol, which is called a fly client protocol. It was created by Benedict Boons. And what it allows the wallet to do is to verify the information received from the node, even though the wallet does not have direct access to the current state of the blockchain. It's very important for the wallet because it does not want to implicitly trust the node, because after all, the node can be lying or providing false information. And the fly client protocol allows the wallet to verify that the answers it receives from the node are correct and represent the correct state of the blockchain, even without having the low level access to all blockchain related events. So in this case, what is the difference between connecting to a random remote node or a specific remote node? And the difference lies with something called an owner key. The owner key is a special secret key which is generated from your seed phrase in your wallet, and it is used to tag your UTXOs in the blockchain in a way so you and only you can always recognize your UTXOs when you look at the blocks. It does not allow to spend beams, because for that you need another set of keys which are kept secret in the wallet. But this owner key also should be kept secret, because anyone who knows it can detect your ETXOs on the blockchain and thus calculate your current balance. If you provide this owner key as a parameter to the node, it becomes your own node, and it now can detect your ETXOs on the blockchain and thus keep the updated state inside the wallet with exact balance at any time. How do you get this owner key? So in the latest version of the Beam Desktop Wallet, we have added a button in the settings screen which shows your owner key after some password confirmation. And we also have a tutorial on how to run your own node in the cloud, and we will add a link to that in the description to this video below. How do you know that the wallet is connected to your own node or just a random node on the network? For that, we have added an icon in the status line in the top left corner of the Beam Desktop Wallet. If it shows a green lock, it means that the wallet is currently connected to an own node. Or if it shows this green circle, it means that the wallet is currently connected to the random node, which does not know anything about you or your UTXOs. This also explains why it's not a good idea to have two wallets with the same seed running at the same time. Since both wallet A and wallet B use the same owner key to tag their UTXOs, whenever wallet A creates a transaction to spend some of these UTXOs and wallet B does not know about this and can try to spend the same UTXOs later, it will fail, since of course it's not possible to spend the same UTXO more than once. Even if both wallets are connected to an own node which can update them on the state of the UTXOs, the balances will match and all the transactions will be successful. However, the history of the transactions, which is stored locally in each wallet, will not match, and thus the amount seen in the balance field will not match to the total of the transactions, which is also inconvenient, and this is why we do not recommend doing that. Now that we have discussed all the nuances of the wallet-to-node communications, let's see what's going on when two wallets try to create a transaction using the SBBS system. So first of all, these four steps have to happen. The receiver creates a new SBBS address and passes it to the sender. The sender then sends the init message, which starts the transaction, receives the reply from the receiver, and completes the transaction and sends it to the network. So this is very nice and convenient. However, there are some details that are important to understand in the SBBS implementation. First of all, whenever you press the receive button, a new SBBS address is generated with the default expiration time of 24 hours, which means that after that time, it can no longer receive messages. Of course, you could change the expiration time to never, but this is only recommended for special cases, like when you are constantly receiving mining rewards to the same address or some other special uses. And for the regular transactions, it's recommended to stay with the default value. In addition to that, the message itself only lives within the SBBS system for 12 hours, after which it expires. And what this means in practice is that whenever you want to send some beams to somebody, you call them up and you say, listen, I'm going to send you some beams, and you hit send. And then within a couple of hours, the other wallet wakes up and receives the beams, sends the reply transaction back. And then you should be also online within the next 12 hours to get that message and create a transaction and send it to the network. So the idea behind the Beam service is to actually separate the part which is responsible for managing the transaction state, the history, and the blockchain events from the part that manages your keys. And that way, what you have is your wallet that becomes a very thin client that only manages your keys and all the signature and the code for creating only the secret parts of the transaction. And all the other functionality, including the transaction state management, the history of the transaction database, and the blockchain events, is delegated to this remote service, which runs constantly on another machine, and your wallet can connect to it, send and receive beams, and do all the other operations that you need. Of course, in order for that to work, you need to delegate the ability to parse and decrypt the SBBS messages to that service. So it means that it should know your SBBS keys. And as I mentioned, it could be a problem if the service is hacked, so somebody could hijack your SBBS messages. So in order to prevent that, what we need to do is to create an additional wallet ID component, which will be only managed in the secret part of the wallet, and it will provide an additional signature that will prevent this hijacking from happening. Of course, you could always opt to have more security rather than more convenience and only move some of the functionality of the wallet to the service. And what we're currently working on in the next couple of months is the ability for you to choose the level of convenience versus security that you want to have. So for example, if you don't want any history of the transaction stored on the service, or you do not want the node that runs within the service to know your own key, you can choose not to have that and rather have this information always sent from your secret wallet part. And thus, it's up to you what level of security or convenience you prefer to choose. Another very interesting thing that the wallet service solves for us is the ability to integrate Beam into other wallets, because that was historically one of the biggest pain points for us. Since there is a lot of complexity in the creating transactions in Nimble, it was never possible to integrate Beam into other wallets, which hurts Beam adoption and was very difficult task to handle. So now we believe that with this new schema, the wallet client becomes very light. It only has very basic cryptography, and thus it could be easily integrated into other wallets as well. The first type of client that will actually use the wallet service functionality will be the Beam Web Wallet. It will basically be a Chrome extension, very similar to MetaMask, and it will only implement the minimal functionality, including the management of the keys, and all the rest of the functions will be delegated to the service at that point. Inside, the Beam Web Wallet is using a key keeper component, which is responsible for all the key management, the signatures, and all the secret stuff that's going on under the hood. It's wrapped with the WebAssembly, embedded into the Chrome extension, and it connects to the service using the WebSockets API. Eventually, it will look something like this. As you can see here, you enter your password and you have access to your wallet, including the send and receive functionality and all the rest of the basic functions you need to use Beam. One of the reasons we want to have Beam Web Wallet in addition to the usability, of course, is also to support integration with bridges. When we implement the bridge functionality that allows you to move assets from Ethereum to Beam and back, of course, it will be integrated with the MetaMask wallet, so you can easily connect the two chains and perform all these bridging operations. We believe that the web wallet will be very useful and good addition to our product line, and we're working very hard to make that happen. And so, to sum things up, in this video we have reviewed how the Beam wallet works in terms of communication, node connection, and connecting to other wallets. We have explained what the owner node and owner key concepts mean, why it's not a good idea to run multiple wallets with the same seed, and we have built up to the idea of trusted centralized wallet service and explained which things it could improve for us and what challenges it presents. We have also seen a small and quick sneak preview demo of the upcoming Beam Web Wallet. Thank you very much for watching. Thank you for supporting Beam. Subscribe to our channels to get more updates, and have a great day.